All right, welcome to a new episode of Cali Claptrap. We have Peter DiStefano. He's most famously known for being a guitarist for Porno For Pyros. Peter, thank you so much for joining me.
You're welcome.
So, Peter, you grew up in California, and were you part of a musician's family? Is that correct?
Yeah, my father played guitar and sang Italian songs, Sicilian songs. He wrote his own songs and played covers. And my sisters were into music and played music. And my younger brother, we all just, got into it.
Well, that's awesome. But did you was he encouraging you guys to pick up instruments? Or did you guys just sort of gravitate to it yourself, being around his
music? Gravitated towards it, yeah.
Yeah.
There was a piano in the house and a guitar. And I would just go and hit the strings on the guitar and hit the piano. And then I listened to music, my older sisters would play, Elvis Presley, the Beatles, and then my father would play really emotional Italian music, and I just got into it.
Yeah. Well, we share that background. I grew up with a grandma that was from Italy. She was from Northern Italy, grew up in San Francisco, but she always talked about the way that the Southern Italians raised their children was a lot different. Obviously, I think Italians were strict, but Southern Italians seem to have more of a kind of a strict vibe to it.
Yeah.
Was that your experience, or did you guys have a pretty good close-knit family?
Very close, beautiful.
Awesome, that's wonderful. So grew up, and then guitar was just sort of naturally your thing?
Yeah, I mean, no, I guess watching on TV, seeing the Beatles and how cool their job was, like I wanted to be, they just look like bad boys, Elvis Presley and mm-hmm. the Beatles. And then as time went on, I got into Led Zeppelin, Ted Nugent, Aerosmith, stuff like that.
Okay, cool. So if you can kind of walk me through sort of how you kind of came into Porno For Pyros.
Well, I was in a band called K38 and doing original surf music and covers of old, Dick Dale music, Hawaii Five-O and stuff like that. And we had a fun little thing happening in Santa Monica. That was our clique. I was born and raised in Santa Monica, California. And then I started to do solo music, and I did a song called Hypocrisies, and I recorded it at a friend's studio, and a friend, Eric Avery, we went to school together. He was in Jane's Addiction, the original bass player for Jane's Addiction, and we went to school together and stuff, and I was surfing with him, and he introduced me to his friend Greg Lampkin, and Greg Lampkin, I had made a demo tape and gave one to Greg Lampkin, and then Greg played it for Perry. And then we set up a surf trip, and we met in Puerto Escondido, Mexico, surfing, Perry and I.
Nice. How much does surf, do you still surf?
Yeah.
Yeah. How much does surfing influence your music style and just in general, your outlook?
Well, everything, music to me is just an expression of how you live. What you're living. So everything I do and everything I experience and perceive is my music.
Mm-hmm.
So nice. Yeah.
Awesome. So you guys met in Mexico, and then things just kind of the synchronicity of things just kind of one thing flowed into another. It was a pretty easy.
Well, I was sitting there finger picking classical stuff.
Mm-hmm.
I had like classical style finger picking inventions, and he was looking at that and he goes, wow, I don't see a lot of people doing that. You should audition for a new band I want to start with, Perk. So yeah. I went to the audition, and everybody was jamming really hard, and I was playing just mellow notes trying to make it all sound good. Then I left, then I told him I just want to play with my brother on the side stage at Lollapalooza. And, but then it was meant to be. We got together, and one night we went to Skate Master Tate's house, and he was playing Riders on the Storm, DJing Riders on the Storm from the Doors. And then I picked up the bow and we wrote Orgasm over Riders on the Storm.
Oh, wow.
And then the record label wouldn't let us do that. So they removed the Doors song.
Oh, okay.
And it's what it is without the Doors song.
Oh, wow. I never knew that.
Yeah. So, but my band Lance Herbstrong, in 2010 on, we were able to do full length mashups of two or more songs and me jamming over them and stuff. So,
okay, nice.
But at that time in the early 90s, it was not allowed.
Yeah, copyright laws. And
yeah, well, still not allowed. I just don't care anymore.
That's cool. And it seemed like, and I guess one of the questions I had was that I was unaware you were friends with Eric Avery. Was there any sort of tension of joining that band after sort of Eric left Jane's Addiction?
No, I mean, we were just, everything's beautiful. I played with Eric in, with Peter Murphy in 2000. Oh, yeah.
Okay, cool.
And we toured together.
So it's just like one big happy family kind of thing?
Yeah, for me.
Yeah, definitely. Well, it definitely seemed like the group got along well, Porno For Pyros. It seemed like you guys were having fun, and I'm sure there was stuff behind the scenes possibly, but it looked like you guys enjoyed just going up there and having fun.
Yeah, I did for sure.
Yeah, I first saw you guys at the Warfield in San Francisco. I saw both shows, and I'm not sure if you recall that show, but
I do, where the front of the place collapsed and all the people got hurt. Yeah
and I know I was down there with my friend, and Martin Lenoble jumped into the crowd, and I ended up grabbing his cigarette, and I had it on my wall for all my high school
years. That's so dope.
Yeah, cool. So it was pretty memorable. And I also saw you guys at La Luna in Portland, I think, a few years later. Cool. Yeah. So, I guess we can kind of segue into it seemed like around 97, you kind of, as I was reading an article, I think Austin, something about, you described kind of getting spun out in 97.
Yeah. Well, I mean, I was spun out, meaning what, like where?
Oh, I think that was just the quote, but you just talked about having your addiction problem come to, I guess, fruition and maybe.
Yeah, I mean, there was, we played the Stone Pony, Perry and I, Porno For Pyros, and he looked at me and he was like, you're just going to take this to the end. You're just going to do this until you just die. You're going for it. And I said, yeah, and so it was like, hurrah. And then I had, cancer, and I was doing chemotherapy, and I lost my hair. I just shaved my head. This is me doing it with a razor. But everything fell out, and it was to the curb, and I had gone through 8 drug rehabs and blah, blah, blah. And I had an out-of-body white light experience, and I was like, I want to live. And so I said, I can't tour right now. I need time to get well. And, And 23 years later, I'm still sober.
Hey, congrats, man. Would you mind sharing a little bit about that out-of-body experience?
Yeah, well, I just, I was in a rehab, my final rehab. And there was this kid from Texas who was a fan of the band Porno For Pyros. He was in there too. And we were eating breakfast together, just him and I at a little table. And he said, I love that song, Blood Rag. And he had like a Texas accent. I love that song, Blood Rag. Mm. And then he goes, my parents don't like you. And I was like, whoa, And then we ate, and he left me a note, and he got up, and I opened the note, thank God. And it was a suicide letter saying, by the time you finish reading this, I will have opened my veins in your bed.
Oh my God.
So then I screamed and ran. And then the nurses followed me to my room, and they stopped him before he did it. And then they picked him up, and he was screaming like a demon.
Oh my God.
And they carried him away. And then I collapsed. And then I had an out of body white light experience where I was in space. And there was a shutter light opening and closing, and I went into it, and like instinct, I knew what I had to do. Go to a 12-step program, marry the woman that had your kid. Jesus came through 100 alcoholics, and they wrote this book, and read it, and just all the shit. And then, And I followed it, and everything was lifted. All of the pain, all of the addiction, everything, it was just gone.
Wow, that's an amazing story.
Yeah, so I don't know if it was real or I was hallucinating, but I followed it. And
oh, yeah, that's real, according to my definition.
I don't know if it's real. It could be, you know, I got, you know, abducted by UFOs, or I had an out-of-body violent experience, or mentally kicking heroin and crack. Hallucinated all this shit, but quitting heroin and everything was the easiest thing I ever done in my life after that.
Yeah, well, I definitely think
it's real. I believe it's the Holy Spirit.
Yeah, absolutely.
It's helping me. Yeah,
absolutely.
So it doesn't mean I'm a good guy. It just means that I have work to do.
Well, I think it's important to. Yeah, I mean, one of the reasons I started this podcast is for listeners to understand we're human. All of us have troubles, problems, and you know, a lot of us, I think, right now are feeling alone, isolated. And I think it's important to bring in other people to share their story, and people can recognize maybe things that they aren't comfortable sharing with others, but it matters in their life and stuff. And so I could definitely tell from your Instagram, like, that experience was real. You know, it moved you enough to be sober, talking to me today, and 23 years of sobriety is incredible.
Yeah.
Yeah. So, and then at that time, you also had testicular cancer.
Yeah.
Yeah. And so was that, did you know that prior to that white light?
Yes.
Out-of-body experience? Okay.
Yes.
Okay. And so obviously you've had no, it's been in remission, and that's sort of, you have had no problems with that since that one time, correct?
Not of right now. I mean, I could die tonight of a heart attack. I could relapse. I don't ever want to say I beat anything, because I didn't beat anything. It's a gift. Everything in my life, everything good in my life is a gift. Everything bad in my life is because of me.
Oh, okay. That's a interesting way to look at it.
So I feel gifted.
Right.
I'm gifted as a musician, and I'm gifted in my health today. Yeah. That's all I have.
Yeah. So I've kind of, over sharing my own personal story, I've worked with in drug and alcohol counseling since almost out of college and stuff. And one of the questions that I ask, you know, or sometimes comes up is like, if you have any regrets. And often people will say, I don't have any regrets because what I've gone through has gotten me here. And everything can look back as to sort of there was a meaning behind it. Do you share a similar sentiment, or what are your thoughts on that?
I guess there's things I regret, so many things.
Yeah.
But I accept.
Ah, that's it.
That they happened, and I get mad, and I fantasize about changing things, or doing things, or, you know, I should have executed this, I should have done that, I should have, you know, but I accept and I let go, and this is where I'm at. And sure, I would love a perfect track record of making all the right decisions, but obviously, you know, my best decisions were put me in 8 drug rehabs and a mental ward. So 9 facilities and jail, and, you know, so that's where my best thinking. So obviously I would have liked to have made different decisions and taken different actions and stuff, but I'm here, right here, right now, and I accept it. And I try to make things right with people. Like today I posted this, you know, I was on TikTok and I was listening to music this morning, or just watching, you know, the girls dance on TikTok.
Yeah.
And there's just a few of them, the super hot models, that were dancing to this gnarly song. I never heard of Cardi B and you know, and so I just, you know, I'm a 55-year-old man. I accept what I am. I don't try to hide it. You know, I don't want to be, I don't stain my teeth. I want to be, I have 55 miles on me. You know what I mean? 55 years on me. Yeah. Well, I just, you know, I don't want to, I want to know where I'm at. So I have to try to find the latest cutting edge art. Mm-hmm. And so I've decided to look on TikTok.
Yeah.
Because it's the hot thing. And right. Plus President Trump wants to shut it down. So I'm there. I want to, okay, yeah. there's some action right. on this. It's evil, yeah. you know? Right. So then I heard this song. I forgot what it's even called. I found it today. Cardi B, I know, because there was a couple of girls that attacked me directly and left me these disturbing messages on my phone, and even posted a couple of things because it goes from my Instagram to my Facebook. But I'm just being an artist. And so right. it inspired me, and I got into music to be bad, you know? Mm-hmm. If I wanted to be good, I'd go for being the president of the United States. Yeah. Right.
Yeah.
But you know, mm-hmm. no, but you know, so I was like, this is badass. This is, you know, I did it with Tupac, you know? And so what she was singing about was so gnarly. So then I just was so inspired. I went out my front door. I didn't want to wake the kids up. It was early in the morning, and I put my phone up. And I have my little laptop with a little space, with a little speaker bar thing yeah. you put on the top of the laptop. Uh-huh. And I did a little, you know, Instagram only gives you 1 minute. So I did a little 1 minute video of me playing with the bow over Cardi B rapping some evil stuff. And then I, you know, titled it, you know, just me being an artist, me being honest, what I felt.
Right.
And I don't regret it, but there's mm-hmm. people that are upset.
Oh, I
hurt,
see.
You know, and offended and all that stuff. Well, you know, I...
offended because you remixed it?
No, because they don't like her.
Oh.
And I don't even know her, Cardi B. It was the first time I found her today. And what yeah. I heard was fucking dope and evil. And yes. so I wanted to play over it.
Right.
And I don't get into the politics and what gang she's part of and what this and that and... Now I'm against you because she's on the this and she's killing this guy. It's like, leave me alone. I'm just an artist.
Yeah,
you know?
Exactly.
And people get so emotional into it and in depth and everything. It's just, it's a lot simpler than that. I don't have some ulterior gang motive. She was dope. I can't find any male singers that are as badasses as Cash Doll and Cardi B and, these black rapper girls that are gangsters, fuck. And so I want to play my guitar with that, you know?
Yeah, totally.
And so I don't regret that. But people
yeah, definitely.
Are pissed, you know?
Yeah, well, screw them.
Yeah.
I mean, you got to do your thing and try to keep that big bubble out, you know? To me, I always believe there's like a bubble around us. You got to keep the bad out and the good in. And that bubble's meant to protect us. And anyone who's there, not there to, you know, help me, then they're outside my bubble and I got to keep them out there.
Yeah, I mean, I could keep it safe and play a politically correct tune and jam over it and stuff, but I just, you know, I was inspired. It inspired me. I go, this is bad. And this is, these girls are, you know, they're dancing, you know, these supermodels are dancing like whores to this evil music. It's so fucking wicked. I want to be a part of it. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
55-year-old man wants to jump in with how he can do it. I can't rap. I can't live like they are. So, but I could play the guitar.
Definitely.
And so that's what I did.
So, Cardi B, if you listen to this, Peter would love to play on your next album is what I'm saying.
Yeah. Well, I mean, basically I got what I needed. You know, I love to, you know, my band Lance Armstrong, we just take everybody's music and mash it. I think it's a compliment when someone takes your music and jams over it or whatever or mashes it up and stuff. And so,
yeah,
I just spun it and jammed over it, and I would have posted the whole song if they give you more than a minute, but they don't.
Right.
So, but I think
YouTube.
It's super dope. Yeah,
and
then I have to go there, and then, you know, it's just Instagram's really easy for me.
Awesome, man. Well, if I could ask you some questions, just in general. Favorite Porno for Pyro song.
It's like asking your favorite child or your favorite pet. You know, I love them all equally the same.
Yeah.
Obviously, for the times, you know, like I'll say, okay, during this time, Black Girlfriend would be great, or during this time, Pets would be great, or during this moment, Blood Rag, or, you know, song. Right. These are songs, Punk Rock songs. Yeah. So it, you know, each, I'll pick different songs to perform, or I don't usually listen to my own music. I make it and I move on.
Yeah.
But yeah, when I do hear somebody else playing it and they want to hear it, I'll listen to it and I'll go, wow. It's almost like I'm listening to somebody else.
Yeah.
That recorded, you know, it's like, cause I'm pleasantly surprised. So that's a good thing, you know?
Right.
I feel so humanity and honesty in the music, and that's what I'm going for. So I've been getting what I'm going for.
Awesome. For the most recent Lala sort of meetup, you guys chose to do Pets and Kimberly Austin. I get the Pets, but I was wondering what inspired you guys maybe to do Kimberly Austin.
Well, Perry's the band. When it comes to, like, my band, Lance Herbstrong, Kamal is the band leader. With my band, Porno For Pyros, Perry Farrell's the band leader.
Yeah.
So that's why it works. I just don't care what he wants to do. He just says, I want to do this. And then it's my job to deliver.
Okay.
And that's it. That's how simple I make it. I don't try to go, oh, let's do this, let's do that. You know? And then when we're writing, I'm just write about the truth.
Mm-hmm. Awesome.
I play the truth and we, you know, we got a couple of real records.
Cool.
That we did.
And
a couple of real singles.
Right. And I know you guys have put out, like, you guys aren't officially broken up, that at any time we might be getting something. Is that still on the back burner and possibly going to happen?
Oh, yeah. Yeah. I mean, you know, the thing is that I needed to go and do a session film career. Like, I wanted to build a huge IMDb.
Mm-hmm.
And I wanted to have my guitar touch billions of people.
Yeah.
And so I was fortunate enough to play the guitar on all the Shrek films and Man on Fire, you know, gigantic Hollywood blockbusters. And so I feel like I've gotten to billions of people, the masses, you know,
right,
with my touch, you know,
mm-hmm.
and even in the darkest murder scenes or decapitating scenes to, you know, the love scene in Shrek or Lion, the Witch and the Wardrobe, you know, from everything in between all of that and car chase scenes and fight scenes and all that stuff. So, and then video games, you know, Call of Duty, Evil Resident 2, all that stuff. Metal Gear Solid. So and then I played the video game awards. And that was to 30 million live stream viewers all on their Twitch and YouTube.
Yeah.
You know, it wasn't even promoted. So it was like 3 times bigger than American Idol's biggest night, you know?
Wow.
And so I feel like now I don't even care about the masses. I'm just doing it for me and my Holy Spirit. And
good for you.
Today, the music that I posted today and jammed over was as good as it gets for me.
That's awesome, man.
Yeah.
I think you have a very unique sound. How would you describe your style or your sound to the listeners?
Well, I don't really pick a certain thing. I have attention deficit disorder, so I'm constantly changing guitars.
Mm-hmm.
I think that the guitar I've kept the longest is that white Les Paul with the hollow body Les Paul, the ES Les Paul that Gibson created for me, you know, and then they started selling them on the mass market at guitar centers and everything. I don't know. I think they did that good. So I think they stopped making them.
Mm-hmm.
But to me, it's like an ES-335. It's like an acoustic guitar, but not big.
Yeah.
And like, you know, fat and long. Mm-hmm. It's more like a Les Paul, like, you know, a Les Paul fits just perfect on you. But they're heavy guitars. And so they hollowed it out for me so I can sing and play acoustically, like around a campfire with it.
Oh, nice.
And then I can plug it in and then, you know, play.
Yeah.
You know, like a Les Paul.
Yeah. Awesome.
Yeah.
Do you still play some of the early Italian music that your dad played?
Oh yeah. I mean, I listen. It's hard for me to listen to my dad, but I recorded my dad before he passed.
Mm-hmm.
It's hard to listen because it hurts, you know?
Yeah. Yeah.
And so, cause I loved him so much. He had the best voice, but,
right.
I need to spend more time doing that. And I have, I played the Italian festival last year.
Oh, awesome.
In Hollywood. And I played and sang "Cella luni mezzo mari, mamma mia mi maritari."
Nice.
"I giuveni giuvai, mamma mia mi maritari. Oh my my, te voglio maritari." You know, and I was doing the guitar accompaniment to that. So yeah, I did perform a Sicilian song.
That's awesome. Yeah. I know Pete's Dad is one of my favorite Porno For Pyros.
Oh yeah, that's a single. And now on the two records, it was just a standalone. That was our Christmas song. Yeah.
Yeah, it's a badass song, and I just
thank you.
You know, it really felt like you were in the room when that happened, and it's that single was awesome.
Yeah. Thank you.
Yeah. What practices do you do to strengthen your recovery?
I do a 12-step meetings. Mm-hmm. I'm a certified recovery coach because I had friends. Like Chester Bennington, he committed suicide, and you know, Chris Cornell. Mm. And I was sponsoring Chester at one point in a 12-step program. And so when you go to jail, you get in trouble. They go, "This either you're out there or you're sober totally." And there was nothing in between. Mm-hmm. A lot of people. So then what I did is I became a certified recovery coach. And I came, there was six models of treatment in with Dr. Caliestas. And so I came up with two extra ones.
Oh, wow.
And I made eight models of treatment. And then I was getting paid to do it. And then one of my client was hiding behind my back and doing it. It just hurt me and I got fired. So then I was like, you know what? I'm not going to get paid to do this.
Yeah.
And just like everything I do outside of music, when I try to do something else that's not music, it doesn't work, whether it's post-production or not. I need to play the guitar. That's what God wants me to do for money. And then, so now I do certified recovery coaching for free. I have people that I talk to every day and help every day for free.
Well, that's incredible. Thank you so much for doing that.
Yeah. Well, I mean, it keeps me alive and sober.
Yeah. So I guess my final question for you, Peter, is I've wanted to interview people that inspire me and that do good in the world. And so my and some combination of that. And my question for you is what advice do you have for others to bring good into the world?
To just be honest, treat others like you want to be treated, you know, that's it.
Yeah. Awesome. Short and sweet and simple. I love it.
Yeah.
Peter, thank you so much for taking time out of your day to be with us and
you're
sharing
welcome,
your story.
Man.
And best of luck in the future. And hopefully we could have you on again in the future.
Yeah, sure. Definitely. Awesome. Thanks, Matt.
Thanks, Peter.